No! It's better than it's in Game 7!
I don't know that it is!
Dude, are you kidding? For the story alone, it's perfect! Game 7! All the cards on the table! Oh, they can't do it! Oh, they can't win the big game! And then they do!
Yes, but it's worse for us, like, physically and mentally.
Oh, it's definitely worse for us, but, like, who cares about us?
Let's go!
Ladies and gentlemen, it's a little ridiculous.
Good boy.
Play all the hits! Left Toronto Maple Leafs! Let me finish! How am I supposed to go to bed after watching that?!
I'm quite hyped. With you wherever you are, welcome to LFR. Leafs lose Game 6, 4-3 in overtime to the Tampa Bay Lightning, forcing Game 7 in Toronto on Saturday night. Listen, I feel it out there, Leafs Nation. I feel what you're going through. I'll make the saying a little bit more PG for all audiences, but I've seen a lot of Leaf fans on Twitter tonight, and you don't know whether to poop or wind your watch. You can't decide what you want to do more. Be mad about Game 6 or dread Game 7. I could show you what Sports Interaction's got for Game 7. The way it is right now, and it could change over the next 48 hours or so, the Toronto Maple Leafs are actually the slight favorites to win Game 7 at home over the Tampa Bay Lightning. Whether you want to bet for them or against them, consider sportsinteraction.com/SDPN. That's the new link. And this is a new year with the same problems. Just like last year, the Leafs go down 2-0 in Game 6. Just like last year, the Leafs go on a 5-on-3 penalty kill that ends up costing them. And just like last year, the Leafs drastically outplay their opponent in overtime, only to lose. But all series long, and including in this game, the Leafs showed they're not last year's team. They're better. Listen, let's talk about the game and let's go through it. Tampa definitely outplaying the Leafs in the first period. The Leafs had more shot attempts, I believe, but Tampa had more shots on goal, 12-6. And they definitely had more time in the Leafs zone. But the Leafs did a great job keeping the puck out of the slot, swatting it away, staying on Tampa, making sure that their chances were watered down. And after such a tight, structured game, it's one gaffe that blows it. Alexander Kerfoot with a drop pass to nobody. Here's the problem. It's a no-look pass to a defense pair in both TJ Brody and Jake Muzzin who aren't looking. So it's a true no-look pass in that no one is looking, except for one guy, Andre Palat. I'm not trying to defend Kerfoot here because you gotta make a no-look pass to someone who's looking. But this pass is so bad that, like, this has to be a miscommunication or something. This has to be. Brody's turning, Muzzin's turning. Both those dudes are going to the bench. They have no shot at catching a streaking Andre Palat. Palat comes in on Jack Campbell, who was spectacular in the first period, but scores. It's 1-0 Lightning after one. And the Leafs, they continued to be good, I thought. In a game that you knew was going to be tightly called, and don't worry, we'll get to that, and it was only going to get tighter as the game went on, Ilya Mikheyev drew what would be the last power play for the Leafs in this game halfway through the second. Kelfoot hooking Ilya Mikheyev, good draw, Leafs go to the power play. Anthony Cirelli with a great effort, Mark Giordano with a great effort, they battle, Cirelli spins, fires, scores. You gotta recognize it, like that's an amazing goal from Cirelli in his first of the playoffs. The Lightning capitalize on two mistakes. That's barely even a mistake. But they capitalize on two opportunities that they had as the Leafs were getting better and better and better as the game progressed, and they have a 2-0 lead. Last year, Game 6 against the Habs, the Leafs were getting their show run from the moment the puck was dropped in that game, and it was only getting worse up until they gave up the 2-0 goal. And not only did the Leafs have the lead by the end of this period, but they were on the board within a minute of this Anthony Cirelli goal. Mark Giordano looking to make up for losing the battle to Anthony Cirelli. He puts it on. This all happens in a flash. Leafs get the offensive zone draw. I thought Keefe did an amazing job at figuring out who was supposed to go where in D-zone draws and offensive zone draws. He did a great job managing the blue lines. He just did a great job in general. The Leafs should have won this game. Matthews wins the puck back to Willie. Willie gets it to Giordano at the point, and Matthews immediately goes for the front of the net. And again, the best goal scorers in the league just know how to disappear. Look at this. There's Ryan McDonough battling with Mitch Marner in front, and Braden Point has Austin Matthews. There's 8:23 left to go on the clock. Do you want to see 1 second later? Bro, what? Why? Why? Braden Point completely leaves him. And look at Vasilevsky doing the meerkat. He has no idea where this thing is, going through a screen. Matthews tips the shot that was perfectly placed by Giordano. Scores! Leafs are on the board. They have life. And the whole rest of the second period, they are rocking. Final minute, about 30 seconds to go. Spencer Tavares shoots it on. It's floating through the air. Spencer with his stick up there. He was originally a
awarded the goal. Andrei Vasilevsky bats the puck in with his own glove. They now have the goal being awarded to John Tavares on NHL.com, which is important because that made it 2-2. And with less than 10 seconds to go in the period, Kerfoot with the brilliant stop-up. He feeds William Nylander. John Tavares goes to the net. He shoots. He scores! In an elimination game, John Tavares with two goals to tie it and gain the lead. Heading into intermission, you can feel it. Now, we all know how this thing ended, but I want to talk about something. On my stream, Watch a Leafs Game with Steve Dangle, presented by Molson Canadian, on the Sportsnet YouTube channel, I was wearing black. I was wearing the Leafs Drew jersey, the Justin Bieber jersey, whatever you want to call it, because this is supposed to be a funeral. The Leafs should have called it curtains on the Lightning tonight. Now, you can call that a jinx if you want. You can call that getting ahead of yourself, getting cocky. Last game, I straight up tweeted, the Leafs are going to win. Enjoy. And everyone called me a jinx, and they were down 2-0, and I was even more of a jinx. And then my mentions got real silent when the Leafs tied it and won it. But I hope above all else, this proves that there are no jinxes. There is no curse. There are no demons. There's only one spectacular hockey team against another spectacular hockey team. And on Saturday night, they will battle through hellfire and brimstone in Toronto. Now in the third period, this was by far the most asked about thing, and it's impossible to get to specific questions. John Tavares on the complaints to the officials over the calls in the third. We don't have any comments about it. John Tavares choosing not to take the fine. I'll tell you who should take the fine. Cal Foot for embellishment. This high stick from David Kampf that leads to the 5-on-3 never happened. It's kinda a high stick. He hits him in the shoulder. I saw some people talking about it hitting him in the neck. Your neck is attached to your shoulder. They're not the same. But it's a dive, it's embellishment, it's disgraceful. If you ain't cheating, you ain't trying. Well, he sure was trying on this one. And the ref calls it because it was sold well. I have a hard time even blaming it on the refs because guys do this all the time. There's a reason there are embellishing penalties and there's a reason there are fines in place. That's what happened here. Now I know it's 2022 and everything is up for debate. I'm not going to argue. There's the footage. Go look at it. And if you don't come away with the conclusion that Calfoot faked it and didn't get hit in the face, I'm sorry about that. I don't know what to do about that. This hat is blue. No, it isn't, stupid Leaf fan! Okie dokie. Like, I don't know. Let that be a little lesson. I see a lot of people trying to change the hockey world one tweet at a time tonight, and that is a waste of thumb. If we can't agree on what blue is, then we're definitely not going to agree on what a high stick is, and if you don't see it, then I can't help you see it. You don't have to say, oh, the officiating was poor, or the refs cost the Leafs the game. You don't have to say that in order to say, the call was wrong. It was. Now, I was pretty amazed because I said it's going to take a lobotomy or like a dismemberment or something to get a penalty in the third, and there's one right there. All right. Okay. Well, one of the key penalty killers is in the box. The Leafs got to kill it. And Kerfoot in the offensive zone on Victor Hedman, one of the tallest players in the league. His stick gets up. Doesn't matter how it got up. It got up. It gets Hedman in the face. And it's a minute 40, 5-on-3. Kerfoot absolutely has to be responsible for his stick, no matter what happened to it. Do the Leafs end up in this position if they simply make the right call on David Kampf, which is no call? No, they don't end up in this position. Cry about it. Like, it is what it is. Like, by the time Kerfoot takes the penalty on Victor Hedman, in the offensive zone, that's an unforced error. The milk has already been spilt. Should the Kampf penalty have been a penalty? No, but it's up to the Leafs to kill it off, or at very least not take a penalty to make it worse. For the second straight year, the Leafs, in a game six where they have a chance to eliminate their opponent, go down 5-3 in the third period. It's unbelievable. Only difference is last year the Leafs were losing, this year they're winning until Nikita Kucherov scores with a 5-on-3, and the Leafs still have to kill the rest of the penalty, which they thankfully do, because if they don't, I don't want to know the inferno that it would be online. It's a miracle
this game made it to overtime, and it's a miracle it almost made it to the end of the first overtime. 1,000 glorious chances. Kerfoot fed a breakaway with a beautiful feathery pass. Brandon Hagel somehow sending the puck through the crease and not hitting anything. A couple really good chances for Mikheyev. Leafs out shooting the Lightning 9-5 in overtime, for Pete's sake. And the other officiating complaint that people had, besides the David Kampf non-call, was at least one penalty it would have been nice to have called. This from Alex Killorn on Austin Matthews holding the jersey lasted at least 5 seconds. Here is the only thing I can assume. The NHL feels bad that the Tampa Bay Lightning have had these like really short off seasons because they, you know, keep winning the cup. And Alex Killorn was like, you know what, ref? I really like wakeboarding. And the ref goes, say no more, fam! And he just lets him do it on the back of a dude who was nominated for MVP! I know it's overtime. I know it's overtime. And if you watch that clip back, you actually see Michael Bunting knocking over a member of the Tampa Bay Lightning in front of the Lightning net. It's anarchy. But dude, if you look at the way both Game 5 and Game 6 were called in the first period versus the second, third, and overtime, it's not close. It's not even the same sport. And again, without saying the refs cost the Leafs the game because they didn't, Tampa Bay won. Tampa Bay won. Give them their due. This got to be a call. He held the guy on his jersey for 5 seconds. I encourage you to go back and watch the clip. It's surreal. Tic-Tac-Tomar on Twitter has it. It takes forever. And then, how does the game end? Well, if you were watching the stream, you know I didn't get a great look at it because we were trying to fix my microphone and I was actually muted for when the Leafs lost. Perhaps a good thing and allowed me to swear. Would have been a shame if my mic wasn't even on for the Leafs sealing a series. We didn't have to worry about that though. It was no one's fault. Technology breaks sometimes, whatever. Matthews blows a tire in the neutral zone. The Lightning turn it back up the other way. In comes Brandon Hagel with speed. Mitch Marner is on him. Justin Hall goes to cut him off, like the Leafs have been doing all night. The problem, I think, is because Bunting has to come and fill in for Matthews, but he's too far back. And this is it, right here. This is where the game is. Hall in on Hagel. Marner goes to make up for the compensation, but he's far behind. Giordano's already dealing with someone. Tampa gets two whacks at it. Braden Point gets the second. It goes through Jack Campbell. And heartbreakingly, if you go back and watch the clip, Michael Bunting, I think, was about to clear this thing. Honestly, the puck might have slid under his stick. He might have only got a piece of it, and it might have gone into the net anyway. But both Michael Bunting and Justin Hall got a piece of this, and Hall helps it across the goal line. If neither Leaf touches it, it's going across the goal line. If Hall touches it, which he did, it goes across the goal line. If Bunting touches it and he's the only one, there's a chance. A slim sliver of a chance, but a chance nonetheless. And we'll never know because the puck crosses the line in the Lightning force Game 7. Leafs in 7. Still confident? Yes, I am! Leafs have been the better team for the majority of the series, and they were the better team for the majority of this game. They were definitely the better team for the majority of overtime. Leafs outshooting the Lightning 9-4, and I'm pretty sure two of those four came on the goal. How like last year, c'est la vie. But the Leafs have home ice advantage. The Leafs have won more games in Toronto in this series than Tampa has. The Leafs have proven over the course of an 82-game regular season they were the better team than Tampa, and that is why they earned the right to have home ice advantage in Game 7. We have all earned the right to have that building full and rocking! 20,000 people in Scotiabank Arena on Saturday. Thousands in Maple Leaf Square. And what I'm sure will be 30, 40, 50,000 plus in the chat for Watch a Leafs Game with Steve Dangle on the Sportsnet YouTube channel. The entire hockey world will be watching! Nostalgia's your thing, maybe this will help. From Richard Coffey, if you care about the Maple Leafs playoff history on Saturdays, since 1993, overall record is 13-8-2. Toronto last played in Game 7 on Saturday in 1993 in every single series. 3-2 OT win over Detroit, 6-0 win over St. Louis, and a 5-4 loss to LA. And you know what that means? Nothing, because it's not 1993! It's 2022! The Leafs haven't won since 1967. Who cares? The Leafs haven't won a playoff series since 2004. Wow! The Leafs shouldn't think about any of that heading into Saturday, because why should they? Last year, the Leafs' best players were outplayed, and they weren't able to close out the series. This year, The Leafs' best players have arrived. Tavares has played his best two games of the series in the last two games. Matthews got the Leafs on the board. Marner, I'm convinced, plays 65 out of every 60 minutes. Campbell has been marvelous, and against Andre Vasilevsky, who has allowed at least three goals in every single game of this series. Andre Vasilevsky, are you kidding? Why bet on the Leafs on Saturday? Because why not? A bunch of the recent Stanley Cup champions didn't win until they weren't supposed to. Washington Capitals choke in 2017. They should blow it up, that's as close as they're gonna get. They win 2018. St. Louis Blues begin 2019 in last place. Remember, trade Pietrangelo, trade Parayko. Should the Leafs go get Parayko? They end up winning the cup after coming out of 31st. In the Tampa Bay Lightning, the year after winning the President's Trophy and choking in game 1, 2, 3, and 4 against the Columbus Blue Jackets and getting swept. Barely change a thing. They don't get rid of basically anybody. And they go on to win the 2020 Bubble Cup without their captain, pretty much. Except for one shift where he scored, by the way. And then they follow it up again the next year. On Saturday, be the team who's not supposed to, but does! And you know what, Leafs fans? You know what? Why does this always happen to us? Why does it have to be this way? I'll tell you why it has to be this way. Because this is the best. This is absolutely the best. Are you kidding me? Saturday night, the Leafs have an opportunity to knock off the reigning and defending back-to-back Stanley Cup champions at home in front of a packed barn. Game 6 was the best hockey from start to finish we've seen from both teams. The tightest this series has been for both teams. And in Game 7, how could you expect any different? We should expect the best hockey we've ever watched, the most entertaining hockey we've ever watched. We're not going to be in our seats for a moment. Even if you go to the game and you paid for it, you're going to be standing the whole time. You're going to be on edge. You're going to be floating above that thing. Guys, this is what we're here for. This is why we cheer. That nervous feeling you have, those jitters, that tight chest and everything. No, Steve, I don't want that. This isn't what I want. This sucks. No. You're misunderstanding. You're misidentifying. This is the feeling that comes before the euphoria of victory. And I think a lot of us have forgotten that. Because a lot of us have this feeling followed by empty, hollow regret and disappointment. It's not going to happen Saturday. It's not. I had a vision. And I believe in it. I really do. If you allow yourself, you might see it too. Game 7, Saturday, Leafs Nation, lucky us. Lightning fans, lucky us. Isn't this so fun? This is going to be so fun. I'm not even talking myself into it. I am genuinely jacked to watch this. We all should be. It's going to be awesome. That is it for this one. Thank you very much for watching. Click like if you like this video. Click subscribe if you really liked it. Tell all your friends. Lucky us. Leafs, Lightning, Game 7. No dragon slaying. No killing your demons. No erasing the past. It's about creating the future. And I can't wait.